here in the perimeter, there are no stars. Out here, we is stoned, immaculate.
Hello, and welcome. This is the C86 Show. I'm David Eastaugh. As you know, we love a special guest. This week, it's going to be the turn of Mood 6, because I recently spoke to Phil Ward very, very, very recently to find out more about life, love, poetry, and all that other groovy stuff. Anyway, this is it, Mood 6, the neo-psychedelic combo formed in London. Anyway, look, after several minutes of casual chat, we got down to that exciting subject that was the early formative years of the young Phil. Phil, tell us more. Tell us now.
We were quite lucky as kids because we were, I guess in a way, we were slightly too young for the Beatles, but my parents were quite good at they used to buy us the albums and things. So we got into music a bit earlier than some of my contemporaries, you know.
Yes. Were your parents quite hip and happening then?
I guess they were, actually. They were a wee bit, yeah. They weren't, I wouldn't call them by any means bohemian, but yeah. But culturally sort of aware, you know, they used to be into jazz and comedy shows. They were friends with the scriptwriters, Gorton and Simpson, you know, Hancock and
yes. And, my God, that was quite hip and
Depto and Son. Yeah, so they were quite they were into all that.
Because my parents, you know, we grew up in the countryside in East Anglia. I mean, we weren't hip and happening at all. It was all very, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
It wasn't a lot happening in those kind of worlds, you know. So
So
the writers of Hancock is pretty impressive, really.
Yeah, they also knew Johnny Spate that wrote Let Us Do Part.
Bloody.
Which was the Afghanic, you remember the Afghanic
character? Oh my God, yes, that's so...
Probably not. You wouldn't see him on TV now.
Well, it's interesting because I did sort of play some of those kind of clips kind of a few months ago. And it was quite weird, wasn't it? You know, that was Steptoe and Son and Alf Garnett. That character was just relentless, wasn't he? You know, and I was curious because he was quite an educated chap, wasn't he? He'd gone to Oxford but then he played this character, which was just, you know.
That's right. Warren Mitchell, yeah, he was quite well-spoken, yeah.
Really?
Yeah, clever guy, yeah.
But yeah, that was quite a relentless kind of comedy act that he didn't stop, you know.
Yeah.
God,
yeah.
Your parents knew the writer. That's quite impressive.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, they did. They did, yeah. So they were quite, I don't know, I guess we're a little bit ahead of the curve with some of the music. We were really, really quite young, you know. So really into all the fairly typical 60s bands, really, the Beatles and the Stones. Small Faces and the Kinks. They really like the Kinks a lot. The Kinks.
Yes.
But then, like you, I was into, really, really got into T-Rex and Mark Bolan in a big way. Loved him, you know. And I guess my fantasy wasn't really to be him. It was to be maybe his bass player or something. And he would gaze over at me on stage. and then Bowie as well, same as you.
Yes. That was interesting.
And then also... loved Roxy music as well.
Yeah.
Well, early Roxy music.
The Brian Eno period.
Before they got, Brian Eno, yeah, before they got all smooth.
So were you going towards an arts background at this stage?
Not really. I mean, always into music. I think I always knew I wanted to be in a band. Not particularly, no. So thing as well, I used to act a little bit at school, so there was that side to things.
Got you, yes. So when did you start sort of developing your sort of a bit more of a musical kind of moment? You know, when did things start to change?
Actually, very, very early, very early. As quite a young kid, I used to sing along to records all the time, but not just sing along, also pose in front of the mirror, you know. I was throwing some shapes.
Yes, well, absolutely. I mean, we all probably did in a slightly embarrassing way.
Later on as a family, I always found that I've got two brothers, my mum and dad and two brothers will be in the front room watching TV, and I'd be in the other room singing along to records in quite a self-conscious way. I didn't really want to be heard. I think it probably helped me in a way, because I was trying to sing the song so accurately that you perhaps couldn't hear that I was singing along.
Yes.
Kind of like one voice almost, you know. So,
well, singing is quite a thing, because I remember being at primary school and the headmaster who was obsessed with his kind of singing. I mean, he was really, you know, it's like, you can't swing, sing, go to the back, you know. So it was like at a very early age, you're already sort of humiliated.
You're in or you're out.
You know, you were just gone, you know. It's like, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was kind of quite brutal, really. I mean, he was quite a character, really, on that front. He was obsessed with hymn practice, actually. So that kind of frightened me. So learning to sing and find your voice is quite an impressive thing.
Yeah, I mean, even in primary school, actually, I did get a little solo spot. So I must have known fairly early on that I could sing.
Yes.
Yeah.
So as the 70s progressed, obviously there was that kind of period of glam, but there was also heavy metal developing, and there was also prog rock, which I had an older brother, and he was very into prog rock. He was that perfect age, you know, where suddenly, you know, that coincides with what's happening, and it was Yes and Genesis and Wishbone Ash, Bark, James Harvest, and even the solo work of Rick Wakeman. And I was obsessed, you know, I thought he was fantastic. So I used to listen to all these records. Well, he banned me from his room, so I'd have to creep in when he wasn't there and listen to them and put them back carefully. But
yeah,
you know, I really liked them. And bizarrely, you mentioned the Beatles, because we didn't have a record player in the house until the early 70s. But I do remember he bought Goodbye Yellow Brick Road and also Sergeant Pepper. You know, this was probably quite early, 73 74. And looking back, you think, God, actually, the Beatles had only just split up, but it seemed like a completely different period, didn't it? You know, it's like, quickly, you know, they would become, you know, back there, really. They were over.
Yeah, yeah. Well, so much happened so quickly. And at that time, I think the 70s, you had so many different types of music that came and went, whereas these days, there's no distinction between from one year to the next, in my eyes, anyway.
Yeah, well, it was interesting because then in New York you had the Stooges, and then you had the New York Dolls developing, and then that sort of world with Johnny Thunders and CBGBs and sort of that early kind of punky stuff. And then in the UK, punk as well started to happen, and pub rock. So where were you kind of during the mid-70s then? Where was things kind of started to develop for your sort of musical moments?
Well, you know, I think once punk came along, you weren't really allowed to say that you ever liked prog rock. But now, who cares? So, I definitely had a period of being into prog. If you were into music at that time, at that age, you were into prog rock. And same as you, I had a brother slightly older than me. And so I definitely got into all that stuff. Never heavy metal, really. That didn't really appeal to me too much. But yeah, the prog stuff was good. And then I suppose got into punk, you know, to a certain extent. So just kind of whatever was current.
Yes. And as we progressed through the 70s, the glorious decade, I have to say, initially it didn't have a great press, did it? Because the 60s, it looked so fantastic. But then later on, you're thinking, actually, that was quite good. I think it was just that there was a lot of political strife, and there was obviously lots of bombings as well going on. And you know, the government was constantly changing. But then 79, Thatcher gets in, and it all kind of slightly changes, even though unemployment starts to rise rapidly. You know, during that period then, so where were you sort of, because this is obviously close to when you know, the band begins to come together.
Yeah, we'd say 79, Thatcher and all the rest of it, I guess it all sounds doom and gloom. But for me, 79 was a great year, because 79 was when I first started to sing in a band. 79, I first got up and sang live towards the end of 78, and then formed a band in 79, and we started doing gigs that year. So that was a great time.
And who was your band at that stage? Was this anything to do with the one, you know, Mood Six that comes along in a bit?
It wasn't. There were some connections. I'm just going to have a sip of water. We were predominantly we were a covers band, really. We did start to write our own material towards the end.
Yes.
We were a covers band, and we were covering 60s material, which seemed like it was a long time ago, but really it wasn't.
No, absolutely.
And, we got kind of lumped in with the mod revival a little bit.
There was one band that, I mean, you mentioned the Kinks. There's also another band called The Action. Did you ever come across The Action as well?
Yeah. They didn't really quite make it, did they? Their songs should immediately spring to mind, but I can't think. But yeah, I do know of The Action, yeah.
Because there's another band that I did, you know, I did the VIPs, but also another one called Direct Hits, who were from London town.
Direct Hits. Yeah.
Ben and Gino, they're
good friends of mine, actually, even to this day. So, yeah. And I speak to Colin all the time, yeah.
Yeah, so...
That's when I met him. I met him around about 81.
Okay.
And we've been good friends ever since.
Right. That was Colin I spoke to. So, yeah, so obviously there was something in the water at that point, because they were quite a similar band, weren't they?
They had some great songs. He really had some great songs, yeah.
Yes.
And good lyrically. You know, same as us, it just didn't quite happen for them. But yeah, they were good. They played predominantly London gigs, but they did one or two tours of Germany and stuff and got up to all sorts. So yeah.
Yes. Well, they've got a reissue on Optic Nerve Records coming out as well. So.
Yeah, that's right. Colin's always got something about to be released. He's always plugging away.
It's quite impressive because you know, from the wonderful world that, you know, the depths of East Anglia. I mean, one of the main bands that you could never say anything about or anything negative was Status Quo. You know, it was a bit of a heavy metal pub environment I grew up in, but at the same time, you know, obviously we were aware of Top of the Pops and stuff like that, so things like Two Tone that came along seemed very exciting, but you couldn't admit it because you would literally get beaten up for being a mod. so Status Quo was the one band. I mean, the Quo fans were quite extraordinary in that period. But we didn't, I mean, we had Two Tone. I wouldn't say mod, because I think, you know, it frankly would have never got to East Anglia. So it's interesting that was happening. Why do you think there was such a mod revival at that point?
I don't know how it started, really, but I mean, it's only really a decade after it all happened, isn't it? So maybe it was possibly stemmed from, you remember the film Quadrophenia?
Oh, God.
That came out around about 78. That might have had something to do with it. You're grimacing.
No, I just remember thinking, of course, Quadrophenia all makes
sense. That probably was the spur, actually, yeah.
Yeah, that was, you know, it's a great film, and I just, yeah.
Yeah. Because at that stage, funny enough, our drummer in that first band, he was quite a lot older than us. He was about 8 years older than us, and he had been an original mod, and he was quite strict with us. You know, we had to wear the right clothes.
Yeah, but it's interesting how tribal it was, because there's quite a few people I've done interviewed who have been, you know, into that rockabilly world as well. A lot of people from Essex. And the precision that you had to have to be part of that gang, kind of 24/7, was, you know, frankly, quite, it sounded like hard work. But a lot of them formed a band called the Rockettes, who got kind of picked up by a guy called Lee Childers. And they kind of went over to New York, even though they could hardly play.
Lots of ease.
Yes, that's the one.
Yeah.
Lee Black Childers. And they seemed to be a bit of a mover and a shaker, because he'd worked with people like David Bowie and others like that.
Yeah.
And obviously had connections and said, oh, look, you look good. Let's take you to New York. And it's like, yeah, but, you know, we can't play instruments. But it's like, yeah, don't worry about it. We'll sort that out when we get there. And they became the darlings of New York, you know, Andy, you know, hanging out with Andy Warhol and Robert Mapplethorpe, which I thought was just a bizarre story. But
yeah.
All true. So so the sort of rockabilly and the mods must have been so, how did you get on with each other? What was the vibe?
Well, there was that whole thing, the mods and the rockers thing was the 60s thing, wasn't it? But not so much mods, but punks. Teddy Boys kind of arrived again at around the same time as punk, and there were fights between punks and Teddy Boys.
Yes.
So that all started up again. So they didn't see eye to eye, no.
Yes, but then as we turned the decade, and you know, obviously the country was getting into more of a pickle because of there being the Falkland War. This is when Mood 6 starts, isn't it?
Yeah. I think it was 81. I think it was the early part of 81. We got together. Yeah. We came together through there were lots of bands playing on the same South London pub and club circuit. The Mood 6, we were a South London supergroup, you know. We formed from the ashes of four bands. Security Risk. Two of the members came from a band called Security Risk. That's Tony and Andy.
Right.
Have you heard of them?
No.
They were quite punky. They usually played on punk balls, you know.
Yeah.
But was an interesting choice of covers thrown in as well. And then there was Guy and Paul. They came from the VIPs. So Simon came from the Merton Parkas.
Right.
And I was from the Acid. So those four bands came together to form Mood 6.
So it was a South London supergroup that sort of...
Absolutely.
My God. Did you start... I mean, did it all come together as in you all... Slightly, you couldn't have all answered a yad. So did someone pull it together?
Did you say?
Yeah, did someone?
Yeah. It was, it didn't happen. I mean, the first band I was in, it happened organically. You know, we'd been at school and people we met in. But this was kind of, we were kind of thrown together a bit. We knew each other or knew of each other, but we weren't real close friends or anything.
Yeah.
And it was really, I think it was the VIPs connection that they were the kind of ones that pulled it all together.
Right.
It was their manager, two of their members. In fact, before we came up with the name Mood 6, two or three kind of warm-up gigs, we were known as the new VIPs. So the VIPs were kind of the main thrust, I think, early on.
Yeah. And then someone just remembered the new Seekers and thought, you can't really do that, can you? The new VIP. It would be too similar to the new, you know, that.
Yeah, it was never going to stick, but we wanted to start doing a few warm-up gigs, and we had to have a name, but some of the original VIPs fans came along and thought, who are these blokes, you know, I don't like this very much.
No.
So I think we lost that audience pretty much straight away.
That's so cruel, isn't it? Yeah, so did you, I mean, because having done this show for quite a while and these interviews, mostly bands have that kind of quite a predictable narrative, don't they? You know, they get together, you know, have that 12 months honeymoon period, well, kind of. And then, you know, in those days, you know, John Peel would get the single and give it a play, and that would give them the John Peel session and then the album and, you know, the tours around the country. How did your narrative develop?
It wasn't quite the same as that, because we came and went a few times. We kind of split and got back together and lived without each other. So the first version of the band was fairly short-lived. I mean, that was the band that was when we had our success or almost success. It really only lasted about 18 months. Then we all went our separate ways and did various other bits and pieces. So by 82, we kind of split.
Right.
And then we went away, came back again around about 84, and we had the second go.
Yes, that's amazing, because the material that you record in that early period is incredibly beautiful, isn't it? I mean, it does sound really good. God, I'm going to have to, nearly 40 years later.
Yeah, well, I'm glad you think so, yeah.
I know, I suddenly get confused with decades now. I think that was 30? No. Yes, only 40 years ago, which is...
Only 40.
Only, yeah. 40. Oh my God, I'll need to sit down or stand up and sit down. So God, that's incredible. So you must have, did you, because at that stage, you know, there was the early period of indie pop. I put indie pop down between the years of 83 to 87, which are the years of the Smiths, so it's not a scientific fact. But before, you had that punk period, and then you had the post-punk, you know, world of, you know, Magazine, Gang of Four, Peel, the Nightingales, and all those, you know, like the Fall with Marty Smith. Did you sort of feel that there was any, you know, you were sort of part of any scene at that stage? You must have been part of the South London scene, I suppose.
Yeah. The new psychedelia thing had, come and gone. That didn't last very long at all. In fact, I often wonder what happened to all the bands that were, you know, our contemporaries, because it just seemed to fizzle out, you know, just know what happened to them. So yeah. When we got back in the mid-80s, I suppose we were part of that whole indie thing, really.
Yes. Yeah. Well, things really changed, because I remember there was like the early years of sort of Julian Cope and Simple Minds and U2.
Yeah.
And then, you know, once that Morrissey Smiths moment happened with Johnny Marr you know, there was something kind of like, okay, you know, that generation of youngish people are going to latch onto that. And then what I realized that every, you know, 16 to 18 year old wants their scene, really, isn't it? So by the sort of, I don't know, 87, 88, you know, people are a bit like, you know, we want our own thing. And that's when, you know, by then the world of ecstasy comes along and everybody is beginning to sort of, you know, the next movement really is going to be the dance world, isn't it? With, you know, that kind of particular vibe. And then that changes again. So, yeah, so what was the reason? You did several amazing singles, which still sound amazing, you know, fantastic today. So why did the band sort of have a bit of a hiccup after just a couple of years?
I think probably because we were signed to EMI early on, and then those singles that we released obviously didn't chart, got to the outer reaches of the chart, or maybe beyond the outer reaches. Is there such a place? Anyway, it wasn't a hit.
Well, really, wasn't it?
Sorry.
You said the outer reaches of the charts, and I was thinking, I just thought of the bargain bin, really, was the kind of...
Yeah.
In Woolworths for 10p.
Yeah, it kind of, I guess, I don't know, I guess we were sort of disappointed and it kind of fizzled out. I can't really remember the reason we went our separate ways the first time around, but there was definitely no fallout. You know, we were all friends still.
Yeah.
And then so we thought we'd give it another go, because there was definitely unfinished business. We had all these songs that we hadn't recorded. We'd only put out only one single, because MI dropped just before the second single came out.
Yeah. Was it kind of a tricky period? Because there's several things at that point. Because I remember there was a huge amount of unemployment. The Falkland crisis had happened. Then we had the miners' strike, and the country felt quite divided. But then a lot of bands, you know, they were at that age where signing on, claiming Job Seekers Allowance and Enterprise Allowance schemes were all sort of things you felt okay about. It didn't feel like you were a failure in life. It just felt like that's what you do if you're sort of
that's the party you've chosen. Yeah,
the left of center, as we say, you know, the SWP, TVP, Barley Cup world of, you know, yeah, just feeling like, well, that's it, there's, you know, it's all a bit rubbish, really. Now we look back, it looks quite brilliant. But student grants, were you a student at that stage, or were you signing on, or how were you sort of making it all work?
No, we were a bit different, actually. We were good boys, you know. We had jobs. We weren't, well, not the whole time, but we were kind of beyond the point of being students, and most of us had jobs at the same time.
So, yeah, because I think at that stage on the EMI, I think they even had the farmers' boys from the depths of Norfolk, so they were obviously.
I'm not sure if that was the same time or just after. I mean, the big band on EMI when we were signed was Duran Duran.
Of course,
they got quite big.
They were just slightly big. Because at that stage as well, there was that indie world, which had that vibe and sound. But then you had the Trevor Horn production sound with, you know, people like, you know, that whole Tina Turner and Frankie Goes to Hollywood and ABC and, you know, really... You know, that horribly kind of shrill sound. But then you also had that kind of cool jazz sound from London, like, you know, Working Week and Sade, and is it a band called Loose Ends as well? Was that any, you know, what did they ever come into your... And the what were they called? The Blitz Kids, who were all hanging out with Boy George and Marilyn. Did you ever sort of...
Yeah, I mean, that was around the same time as the first Mood Six, if you like. Blitz Kids and Boy George and all the rest of it. That was kind of a similar time. to when we were first together. But that kind of slick production sound, I think it crept into most bands' sounds, I guess. I think we did become a bit more aware of production values and slick production and stuff.
Yeah.
Although most of our stuff wasn't overproduced. If anything, it was underproduced.
Yeah, you can't. I mean, when you listen to bands like Talk and this is sort of, I don't know, it sounds a bit kind of like, blimey, that's a bit 80s, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I loved their Talk from Colour of Spring onwards. That's like a different band. That's superb. But the early stuff is really a bit too, as you say, cynical and highly produced.
What was your experience in the studio like, you know, with finding the sound and getting a producer and an engineer to complement what you were doing? Or were you, because you had two members of the VIPs, a bit more kind of studio savvy?
I'd say early on we were far from studio savvy because the first single, for example, it wasn't representative of our sound at all. We were pretty naive, really. And the producer just kind of, I think he produced the kind of record that he wanted to listen to rather than what we had in mind. But we weren't experienced enough really to influence that. Later on, we had more of a say. Then when we got around to doing the first album, it was fairly kind of low budget. So I think songs were great, but I think the production could have been definitely stronger.
Yes. So was Plastic Flowers, was that chapter two of the band?
That was there. It was there all the way through. I mean, it's a song that Tony wrote even before Mood 6 started. And we demoed it early on at EMI, I think.
Yeah.
And finally made it onto, then we recorded it for Psycho Records as a single. And then it was on the album as well. So Plastic Flowers was there all the way through. And then, one of our more popular songs, yeah.
Well, it is. And I have to say, it's still, that's the one that sort of, I suppose it still sounds kind of, you know, kind of timeless, as if anything can sound slightly timeless, you know.
I don't know if we ever really made the definitive version. I mean, some of the early demos are almost stronger than some of the finished, released product. But
yes. And then you're on a B-side. You did that famous Tony Basil song, Mickey.
Yeah. I mean, we're sort of jumping from era to era a little bit, but yeah. But Mickey was 82, I think, and the B-side was she did her version of Hanging Around. Yeah. So that was a number, I think it's about number two, I think. So yeah, that was quite notable, yeah.
Yes, that's right. So when you came back in, you know, for the second chapter, did that feel quite a different vibe with the band?
It did, because it was, because the lineup was slightly different. And the vibe was a bit, well, we were looking after ourselves by then. In the early days, we were quite, there was a bit of a team around us, if you like. We had management and all the rest of it. But the second time around, we were looking out for ourselves and made all our own decisions and probably got on better, stronger as a unit, I think.
Yes. Because that must have been quite something, having, you know, Toni Basil covering your single.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, it was on a B-side, and not everyone plays the B-side, but it was quite something. Yeah, it was on her album as well.
Yes. Yeah. You didn't cover Mickey. Sorry, I said something that wasn't quite.
She covered Hanging Around. Yeah,
you didn't cover Mickey. So did that sort of, who was the songwriter at that time?
In the early days, it was split between Tony and Guy that was in the VIPs.
Yeah,
very, very different in style, the two songwriters. So probably about a third I and two thirds Tony, and then it's been Tony all the way through, really. I mean, sort of latterly I chipped in with one or two songs, but Tony was always the main writer. Yeah.
Yeah. So just how did she manage to track down that song and decide to record it on as the B side to her global smash hit?
I don't know. That's a question for Tony. I'm not quite sure how it came about. And the sad story is he should have made a lot more. He made a bit of money from that, but not as much as he should have.
Yes, I was going to say it would have been one of the...
Which happens, as you know, happens a lot.
I would imagine, yes, if he had signed the right bit of paper, he would probably... He could have had a different life completely.
Absolutely, yeah. He should have earned a lot more than he did.
Yes. So then, because obviously at that stage, are you still based in South London at that point? I mean, were you becoming aware of people like, you know, the, you know, television personalities and Dan Tracy, or was that a scene that wasn't part of your world at all?
No, I mean, that's really, I know Dan was still around mid-80s, but our first connection with him was, again, we're going back to the early 80s again. That's when I first met Dan. So he was definitely part of the scene. In fact, he was kind of a forerunner, really, but we were totally different as bands.
Yes.
But yeah, he was a very important part of that scene. And I got to know him as much as you can with Dan. He's quite an unusual character, but I got to know him and got on well with him.
Yeah, I know there was quite a few bands who sort of signed to his label. Wow. No, Wham.
Wham, Wham. Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, I think it was 1,000 Violins, and they came all the way. They used to stay at his place. They came from Sheffield and would sort of stay at Dan's place and, you know, record and rehearse down in London. So,
yeah, they were on the same bill as us once or twice.
Yeah.
In fact, when we set this up, I listened to a couple of your podcasts. One of them was 1,000 Violins, and it was great. It was very funny, and because we knew them a little bit, but it took me by surprise. You know, it was very interesting, and very funny.
Yes, Colin's quite amazing story, really, isn't it? Yes, I think it was very much of its time. You know, that being in a band, you know, for some people, they could almost do it as a full-time occupation. You know, not making any money, but sort of scrounging. The edges to make it happen.
That's what I got from that interview. Some of these bands were like totally immersed in it. They were doing it all day long, every day. They, you know, because they were on the dole and they could just give all their time to it. And if you can, why not? You know.
Yeah. Well, I realised also at that point there were these great, you know, it was the gatekeepers. I mean, which is both good and bad in a way. But you did, you know, there was the music papers, weren't there? You know, which were sort of very influential. So if you got in them, and they were weeklies as well. I mean, people in America are always like, God, you had weekly papers. Of course they were going to cover bands like Stump and Bogshed and Big Flame, as well as all the anything, because, you know, you had to fill the pages, and you had three of them with the circulation of some.
Yeah, we were quite lucky in that respect, and we had a lot of music press.
Yeah.
But I think with those three big papers, I think you were kind of adopted by one. So yes. It was Sounds that liked us, which meant that NME didn't, if you like.
Yes, absolutely. You know.
Yeah. So Sounds, we were the kind of the darlings of Sounds for a while.
You know? Right. And then and then you had that, and then you had like the John Peel show, which you probably...
Well, we didn't actually. We didn't do John Peel.
You didn't do John Peel, did you?
No. We were the band that didn't.
I know. Well, there's quite a few. There was the guy Lawrence and Felt and Daniela Dax and people like that didn't get the, you know. So I think there's a slight element of kind of like, I don't know. They don't have such fond memories of John Peel.
Have you interviewed Lawrence?
Yes.
Oh, you have? I bet that was interesting.
Yes, you could imagine, couldn't you? Yes, it was
a
very interesting one. Yeah, and various members who were in, is it Shockhead?
Shockhead Peters.
Yes.
Yeah, I remember that name, yeah.
A few of them, their members as well. So, yes, it's quite interesting. But some, you know, some people didn't quite get the blessing. Mm. Well, I mean, it's a bit unfair on John Peel, because, I mean, he just did his show and he couldn't play everything that came out. But
obviously. In fact, perhaps we did. Well, I don't think we bombarded him with tapes and things like a lot of people did. So perhaps it was our fault, you know.
But also,
made more of an effort.
Being in the UK, I mean, it's such a small place, and every city and town would have a club night, indie night, alternative night, and all those kind of cliches. But you know, it meant that most people could kind of travel around and play quite a few gigs around the country. I mean, you obviously got London. Did you find yourself coming to the backwaters of some of those other venues?
No, in fact, probably one of the reasons, probably many reasons, but that's one of the reasons we probably didn't get a hit, because we were only playing London, really, kind of fairly elitist gigs. We played at quite unusual venues and things, but we didn't tour the country, so we didn't build up a following.
Right.
We did have a fan club, and we did get letters coming from all around the country, but they're just sort of ones and twos. But if we should have, we probably, in hindsight, we probably should have toured around the country a lot more and built up a following.
Did you enjoy playing live?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely, yeah. Always have, yeah.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
If only you'd
continue. I love going in the studio. I love recording, but live is where it, live is my thing, yeah.
Yes. So after you did your, was it Psycho label, then you signed to Cherry Red?
That's right, yeah, yeah.
In 86.
Got around a bit, yeah.
You did get around a bit. Because Cherry Red's often the label that people sell their back catalogue to 20 years later. Or they,
yeah,
know.
Yeah.
So did you, so you were still a going concern at this stage?
That was after Psycho. Psycho was kind of mid 84, 85, and Cherry Red was around about, well, just after really, 86, 87. Right, the second album came out on Cherry Red, yeah, and one or two singles, and they were nice people to deal with,
yeah. And then so as we truck towards the late 80s, obviously things start to is this when you start to sort of bump into other people from the, is it the ambulance station?
Sorry to disappoint you there, but we weren't really part of that scene, I don't think. No.
The squatty London scene.
Yeah. We didn't really take that route. No, but I know of it, of course. Yeah, yeah.
Yes. So, is that when you met Sandy?
No. Sandy, knew Sandy right from the very start. She had been the girlfriend of our original keyboard player. When I met her, they weren't really together anymore, but she became, we had go-go dancers, believe it or not, in the early days of Mood 6. She was one of our go-go dancers.
Fantastic.
So I knew her from 81.
Yeah. Nice. Did you have a particular image as well with these? Did you have a fashion consultant?
Yeah, our fashion consultant was probably, again, Paul, our keyboard player. He was the style guru, if you like, yeah.
Nice.
He was a stylish guy, and I guess we all had our jobs to do within the band, and his was to make sure we looked right. Yeah. So yeah, we did look. We did. That was a big part of it. We had the whole dressing up thing. Yeah, there were clothes shops at the time that were dedicated to the sort of gear that we wore. We used to go around Kensington Market and Portobello Road and
right.
And pick up stuff, yeah, or in theatrical shops and go and buy. I bought various jackets that became my go-to jackets, you know.
Nice.
I had quite a fetching pink number with lace sleeves and things. Yeah.
My God. Did you ever see that film? There was a shop which must have been quite famous in London. John Simons? There was a sort of a film about this particular person who had a boutique in London. It all sounded very modish, and there was people like Paul Weller talking about how wonderful it was.
Yeah. And there was a shop called The Regal, which started up at the same time, and they were making really, really authentic looking 60s clothes, but they were brand new.
Right.
And there's also, is it John Simon, you said? There was a guy called Colin Wilde that used to have a shop around Carnaby Street. He was quite a character. He insisted that he invented the flare. Invented flair. maybe he did, but it was that was quite a funny story.
That's kind of amazing. I feel like saying you invented the, you know, semicolon. It's a bit like saying you invented the semicolon. Or
but somebody must have invented the flair trout. Maybe it was Colin Wilde, you know.
I don't know. Could one person have that claim to fame? God, that would be
wonder. Yeah. It's not a well-known fact, though, is it?
No. You're not going to get.
You didn't know, did you? I mean, you didn't know.
No, I didn't know he invented the flair. I don't know.
This interview's been worthwhile for both.
It has been. He has a learning curve.
I hope I've got his name right.
I know. I'll get lots of letters with that. So then, you know, were you, you know, because at that stage, I mentioned earlier, you know, that world that after the Smiths, you know, they split up, Ecstasy comes along, suddenly the next generation wants their soundtrack, which is going to be, not everyone, obviously, because there was more than one little group, but there was obviously a bit of a wave towards people like the Happy Mondays and Primal Scream, Stone Roses. And then you had the London shoegazing scene with My Bloody Valentine and the Faith Healers and Silverfish. And then we had the Seattle scene that came in and just wiped everything as well as, you know, I mean, obviously it doesn't completely, but, you know, the scene. So how did you navigate that period between the late 80s and then into the 90s?
Well, as I say, there were two or three different versions of Mood 6. And I wasn't in the band. After 87, I wasn't in the band. They carried on. Made a third album with a different singer. So I was gone by then. And really, it didn't have much involvement, to be honest, in the music in the 90s, really. I was kind of gone for a while there.
Had you got fed up with it?
I didn't really get fed up with it. And I never, ever said, that's it, I'm not doing this anymore. But just didn't have that much involvement. I was doing gigs, you know, sporadically, but I wasn't really fully immersed in a band or anything. And even the version of Mood 6 without me only carried on, I think, until the early 90s. So I haven't got, you know, many stories to tell you from the 90s.
No, absolutely. Did it feel a bit strange? Because I remember interviewing a few members of a band called Chumbawamba, and they kind of they were going nowhere fast for a long time. Then they had that big single, which was just like gave the band another wave, but then they went down again, and they got to that point where I think half the band decided to leave and the other half continued. And it was kind of the people who continued were mostly the creative, you know, the people who were doing the kind of writing and the music. And you know, it just felt like actually they needed to do something, and so the half the band who were just kind of not so much into that side, even though they might have wanted to, kind of did the, I suppose, the honourable thing to say, look, you continue and we'll go. But one of the members who I interviewed said he did find it a bit strange, and he did feel like, my God, if they have another massive hit and I'm not part of it, I'm going to be a little bit annoyed. But they didn't.
Yeah,
so he could feel like, oh, that's a shame, it just fizzled out and you all finished. Which is always easier. So did you feel a bit strange when the band continued without you?
I didn't really, no, I didn't. They weren't likely to have a hit, I don't think. I mean, that time had long gone, really. I was kind of fine with it, and we all remain friends. I mean, we've been in and out of touch over the years, I suppose, but no, it was. I was absolutely fine with it, and that album as well was kind of, a lot of it wasn't really in keeping with the sound we had before. I mean, Tony's roots are Irish, and some of the songs were almost traditional Irish sounding. It was quite a mixed bag. So some of the songs I couldn't imagine singing, really.
Yes.
So no, it was all fine. Yeah.
It was all fine. And then what do you, you know, after that kind of, I know you had a day job most of the time, but did you, how did you sort of then navigate sort of the rest of your kind of life with kind of doing your career, family probably, and then occasionally doing creative things as well?
Yeah, well, I funny enough, I did reform the band I was in before Mood 6, which was just a covers band, but it kept my hand in, you know, kept me doing gigs and things. So that was good. And then Mood 6 got back together yet again, do a reunion gig many, many, many years after, you know, our last gig. And they were a lot of fun. They were really good and well attended and great. It was really, really worthwhile.
Yes, it's quite nice, isn't it? I mean, it's a funny number, really, the band's reforming. I think if it's just for sort of a bit of fun, it can kind of work quite well, actually. You know,
we didn't really reform it. It was going to be just a one-off gig. But I think we all enjoyed it, and it went better than we all expected. So we did a couple more, and we might do more in future if the virus ever stops.
Stops indeed. Well, it's interesting because I did an interview around the same time, I suppose, your Mark 1 period. So sounds a bit like Spinal Tap, doesn't it, of the Joe Boxers. And I think they had that kind of short period in the early 80s, had a bit of a hit single too.
Yeah.
And then, you know, have had a one or two reunions just for a bit of fun, really. And the singer's in America, so I think they, you know, that sort of slightly...
Was he American?
Dig, or... yeah, he was American. He came
out. Yeah, I thought so, yeah.
So, and they're planning, you know, a date this coming autumn, but he's thinking, I think they had one last year, but that got pulled. So they're, you know, it's interesting that quite a few people think, well, you know, could come over.
The interest is still there, and you can do kind of, you know, they can probably do a medium-sized venue and fill it out. And, you know, people still want, the Joe Boxers fans are still out there, I'm sure.
They are, absolutely. And also, you know, with Mood 6, I guess, you know, you must have also seen people come that you thought, blimey, yes, they remember us. Because there's been a lot of bands, you know, I suppose with these record labels like Cherry Red and Cloudberry and Fire Station Records, and then you've got Optic Nerve, you know, they've kind of helped generate this kind of interest again by reissuing stuff or finding sort of stuff from the archives like the direct hits and thinking, actually, that's quite nice. And it's nicely packaged with sleeve notes and vinyl and all that kind of stuff, so people are quite keen to see the band again, aren't they?
Yeah absolutely, yeah. And I don't think there's much to latch onto at the moment, so why not look back at some of the old stuff.
And we're all just communicating on Zoom, really, aren't we? It's not going to be I think, oh no, yeah. I'm too busy, you know. It's like, well, actually I'm not that busy at all. We're all sort of slightly stuck at home. There's no point in planning anything this year. So does that mean the band, I mean, you've obviously done, you know, had reissues and got all your material out. So is there any plans of any other kind of creative endeavours with the band?
With Mood 6?
Yeah, so is that pretty much done now?
There's not really, no plans at all, I don't think, no plans at all, I don't think, to write new material or record. But I think there is a possibility of more gigs in the future. I wouldn't be surprised.
Yes.
But it's a slight difficulty there because we're not all tucked away in South London now. Tony lives in Ireland. And the later gigs, we actually did Andy's son, Jake, play with us. And,
right.
Which is quite amazing. And but I don't know whether he was a student at the time. I think he's got a day job now, so he probably won't be available.
Yes.
So it's difficult to say at this stage what the lineup will be. I think we will play. I think we will play again. So it just depends on who's available.
Yes, and when the venues open again. I mean, if you could have said something to a 16 or 18 year old self starter, I mean, is there any sort of words of wisdom that you would say that you've kind of picked up over the years and decades of being in the band, releasing material? You know, just having life.
I don't know. I think I'm not bitter and twisted that we didn't make it or anything like that. I'm really quite totally comfortable with it. And I think to be well known in this day and age is probably like a living hell. You know, so much scrutiny. But I think band and myself as well, I think we could have pushed ourselves a bit harder. We could have really given it a push because I think I genuinely believe that we were enough. So I think just give it a bit more. Just make that a little bit more effort to really push it, because even though it didn't work out, the Mark One thing didn't work out. We had made a name for ourselves, so we could have pushed it that bit harder, I think.
Yes. Well, it must be quite nice to know that the legacy of the band is still going 40 years later. It's 20.
And so that would have been good. And so I wasn't 18, but one or two of the decisions we made in the Mark One band as well, probably would have done differently as well.
Yes.
Yeah.
I know, it's tricky, isn't it, really? Yeah. Did you ever have a manager in the band at all, or was it kind of?
We did early days. I spoke to Andy, who played bass with Mood 6 before interviewing you, and he said, I mentioned him. So yeah, we did have a manager early on, but the relationship didn't end up too well, and So we did. So we were quite well. We were quite looked after in the early days. Had a manager and people around us, roadies and all the rest of it. Quite cosseted, you know.
Yeah.
And later on, we didn't have any of that.
Was that easier or better?
Well, for me, the early days of the band, I couldn't quite believe it. I'd just been playing local pubs, and I was suddenly in this band where I didn't have to carry my own tambourine anymore. It was all, you know, everything was set up for us. It was great. Really, we had a sort of good team around us.
Yeah.
But then I think second time round, doing it all ourselves was probably preferable, really. And we weren't being ripped off by anybody.
No. Did you manage to then, with the EMI, with your first two singles, did you get to go into a really nice studio with a producer?
Oh, yeah, we did. I don't think, didn't push us particularly, but they did throw some money at us. The first single, Hanging Around, we recorded at Townhouse, which is a really good studio in Shepherd's Bush. And the second single, we recorded at Abbey Road. So we were, you know, in the same studio as the aforementioned Beatles.
Blimey, you must.
So that was pretty amazing. And even the B-side, actually, the B-side of Hanging Around, which was an instrumental, they sent us away to a studio in Battle in Sussex. I think it was called Parkgate. It was a residential studio. We stayed there for probably a night or two, just recording one instrumental track. So they threw a bit of money at us.
God, it's funny. Yes, because I did I just did an interview with a guy from Micro Disney, and he was just saying that now, you know, still, you know, trying to make music, the one thing he doesn't waste is any studio time. But he said when you're younger and you just kind of go into the studio, you could spend days just faffing about.
Whereas
a bit older, you know, it's a bit like,
it's your own money, perhaps.
Yeah.
So we recorded in some really nice studios early on. Yeah.
Nice. Yeah. God, well, you know, it's amazing. It's brilliant. Just last thing, did you ever make videos at all? Or did you?
Yeah, we did. Only two spring to mind. There's a film called The Groovy Movie, which you may or may not have heard about.
Oh my God, I need to make a note, don't I? The Groovy Movie.
Yeah. Check out The Groovy Movie. It's on YouTube. That was a film of that early, that new psychedelia, that whole scene, but it predominantly featured us.
Yes.
So that's worth checking out.
Did you did you smile and slightly chuckle when you saw the first Austin Powers film then? Did you feel that
we more than smile? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that was that was our scene. Yeah, that was our scene, man. Yeah, I mean, there were clubs as well. I mean, we were doing the gigs, but there were clubs around at the time that were so authentic. They were like walking into a 60s club. You know, if you sort of half closed your eyes, you were in the 60s. And there were kids like younger than us that they just knew all the 60s dance moves. I don't know how they knew them. It was so authentic. It was amazing.
Yeah.
But going back to your videos question, yeah, we did make a couple I can think of. We made one for Hanging Around. That's on YouTube as well. That's a good, fun kind of video. Very, very 60s looking.
Yeah.
Annabelle Giles was in that video. You know the name?
No.
She was married to Midge Ure at one time, and then she went into TV presenting and what have you. She was the love interest in that one.
Mm.
And we did a video for I Saw the Light as well, the Cherry Red single, the Todd Rundgren song.
Blimey, good old Todd. He's still going.
Yeah, yeah. Old Todd, yeah.
One man Todd. Yes. Well, it was interesting. I just listened to an interview he did the other day. He's going to be doing a tour, which was quite weird, but because he's actually going to tour to empty venues, but he's going to try and make it sort of.
I think I read about that as well.
So he's actually going to go to the city, do the sound check, go to the hotel, try and make it as authentic to whatever city it is he's touring, and play the set. And then go and do a tour, you know, then go to another city and do the same thing. It's like, okay.
Yeah, I think I did read about that.
Yes, yeah. He's keeping it real, even though he's probably quite ill, you know, getting old.
Mm.
But that's cool. Anyway, look, this has been, well, Phil, thank you ever so much for this. It's been magic, actually.
It's good. I hope you got enough.
Oh, my God, loads.
We've got what you wanted.
We've got it's quality chat. It's good. No, it's great. And I'm so pleased to get it. Because like I said, I mean, your camera's gone off, but that doesn't matter. You can still see
it. Oh, yeah.
But you can still, you know, you are featured in C86 and all that, the creation of indie in difficult times. So you have got a good mention. Do you hate Barney? Do you hate Barney Hoskins?
Did we
hate him? He's a writer.
We hate him.
Did you hate him?
Is that what you said?
Yeah, because he wasn't impressed with you, was he?
Oh, I think he was the one that did the. Like I said to you, you were either sounds like to us, enemy didn't. He gave us that awful review. Awful review of a gig that was a great gig. I think it was the London Dungeons, wasn't it? Not that it hit hard or anything. Not that I, yeah, I do remember that. Awful. And even the photo was somebody from the audience looking as though he was laughing at us, something like that. It was a nasty review, yeah. I guess I do hate him, yeah.
I don't blame you. Yeah, you should write to him. Anyway, he'll apologise. I think he's full of remorse now.
Yeah.
But look, thank you ever so much, Phil. And yes, I'll send you the link when I put it together. And voila, you can share it with your social media platform sites.
Yeah. So I think we said I could hear the perhaps the unedited version, and then later on the edited version.
Yes, let's do that. Cool? I can just we transfer it over if you want, and then you can.
Yeah.
And have a listen and go.
Yeah, yeah.
Because to be honest, I can't, you know, when I hear my voice, I just think, oh my God. So
I think
we all do. Our own voices are quite spooky, aren't they, really?
Yeah. I know what you mean. Yeah. It was great. I'm glad a couple of people said to me, are you going to find out the questions that David's going to ask? I said, no, I think it's better if it's spontaneous. You don't want a prepared answer and all the rest of it. And I did some revision, you know, I did swat up, but and we didn't cover everything that I thought we might. But
oh my God.
I'm not complaining at all. No, it's been good fun.
It's good. Oh, that's fantastic. Well, thank you for your time. I really appreciate that. And I'll keep in touch. But I'm really pleased you managed to get in touch with Sandy, which is fantastic.
That was really nice, because we lost touch for so long.
Yeah.
And we're now in touch. We keep sending each other long messages, yeah.
Oh, that's great, you know, and it's great.
Yeah, she's married to the guy from that band, The Steps.
The Steps, yeah, I knew it was some band, The Steps.
S-T-E-P-P-E-S.
How do you spell it?
S-T-E-P-P-E-S.
Oh, right, okay, but you.
I've had a listen since I found that out, and they sound pretty good.
Yeah, well, I don't know how she managed to find herself in Las Vegas, but I thought it was quite impressive. And and we were going to go to Vegas recently, you know, last year, and it got cancelled.
Yeah.
But I'd all got all set to say, look, let's meet up and
on
Fremont Street and have a chat. Because I never, you know, it would have just been really nice, but yeah, it just wasn't going to happen. So,
I've got that. I've told you on the phone call that I've got the Suffolk connection. So, I mean, you know.
Right.
I mean, if I'm in your neck of the woods.
Yeah. Yes, give us a shout. Yeah,
that'd be great. I'd like that. Yeah,
it's a good one. Yeah, so yeah, definitely, it's good. But it's nice, you know. I mean, Sandy, because I don't know if you if you're on Instagram or follow her and Gordon on Instagram, but they do occasionally put the odd photograph of themselves up there from their sort of ambulance station days.
Yeah, so. She mentioned that to me. She said to me, "Why don't you do this interview with David?" She said that. You know, you're probably a bigger name than some of the people that he interviews. But she said your Instagram, you could be more active on Instagram. We're not even on Instagram. I suppose we don't really promote ourselves anymore, but it might be quite nice to get some photos out there and stuff.
Oh, people love that.
And stoke up the interest a bit. Yeah,
they would. I mean, you know, I mean, what else are we going to do for the next
10? Yeah. Create that new fan base. Yeah.
Yes, I know. Well, I did notice that suddenly, like, oh yes, everyone must be going in their attic and finding memorabilia, because there was posters, you know, old posters from 30 or 40 years ago appearing on Facebook and Instagram, and it was like, everyone's been a bit bored, haven't they? So
yeah. And I didn't say during the interview, but we did have two Sounds front covers.
Oh, blimey, they did love you.
Yeah, I was on the cover, just me, and then second time round, it was the whole band. So they did. We were in that paper a hell of a lot.
God, you must go and get yourself on Instagram and put them up there. I hope you kept copies.
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah. I remember when it came out, I went down to I heard that it came out slightly earlier near Balham Station in South London. I heard that there's a paper store when the copies come out a bit earlier. So I went down there and I bought about a dozen copies, and the bloke didn't bat an eyelid. He didn't think, oh, that's you, isn't it? So I definitely bought plenty of copies of that.
Oh, nice. That's nice moments, aren't they?
Yeah. Indeed.
Well, that's brilliant. Well, look, thank you, Phil. This is great.
Thank you.
I'll let you go. But yeah, take care, and we'll meet someday in sunny Suffolk, I'm sure.
Yeah. Oh, and I just thought I should ask also, how quickly do you kind of turn it around? When do you think you'll edit and put the show out?
Soon. I could be, yes, I try and be it's quite soon, because otherwise things kind of drop down a bit and you think, oh God.
A weekly show.
Yes. So I'll try and get it up in the next couple of weeks.
Yeah, okay.
Yes, it's all good. But look, okay. Thank you again. It's good.
Yeah, thanks. I'm sorry you can't see me anymore, but I can see you.
That's like BS. Anyway, look, take care. And
cheers, David.
See you later.
Thanks a lot. Speak to you soon. Cheers. Bye.
Indeed, that's how you say goodbye. Now, that is the end of the interview. You probably guessed that. A massive thank you to Phil Ward for giving me the time for that, for Mood 6. This is David Eastaugh, the C86 show. Hopefully I haven't said that already, otherwise I'm really losing my mind. But if you want to contact me, you can on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, that's C86 Show. Also, these have all been archived. You can find those on Spotify, iTunes, Podbean. Just do C86 and that's it, or C86 Show. Have a great week, stay safe, and all that.